The Great White Symphony. It's a classic encounter. Anatoly Karpov versus Garry Kasparov, 1985, marking a great spot in chess history where Kasparov overtook the throne from Anatoly Karpov. But not in this game. And in the course of losing his title, he taught Garry Kasparov a lot of lessons. And this one was an epic one. Karpov managed to massage Kasparov to death on the white squares in we better start seeing it. It's a long and but interesting and very instructive game. I think all players in the world who's got any ambitions in chess need to know this game. Okay, thank you. Let's go. Kasparov is black, Karpov is white. He starts with d4 and here in the first match, he had played the Taras with c5, and this was a total disaster for Kasparov. So he realized, okay, against Karpov, don't get a weakness immediately. That's probably a bad idea. So he was learning to play the Tataco variation, and they both played that, and they played a lot of Queen's Gambits. It was a little bit like the Capablanca-Aljechin match, where there also was a lot of Queen's Gambits. And Kasparov was trying to hang on with black and trying to win with white. Yeah, and this is after Bb4, he would castle and play b6, and they played this also, and black was doing okay. This was very topical in the 80s. Later on, I think it's been more or less out-analyzed, as they would say in German, and there's nothing really to see here. It's just an equal position, and it can easily lead to a forced draw. E3, castle, and the most common move here is rook c1, and Karpov has won some nice games with that, but here he chose queen c2. He might be ready for castling queenside, but this was not really Karpov's style at all. Never was, and probably never will be. He liked to have his king very safe. And knight a6, I think the most common move is d takes c4 or c5. Knight a6 is maybe not the best move. Rook d1, it's a standard move in the Queen's Gambit, trying to deter c5, but black plays c5 anyway because he has a very active bishop here on f6. Okay. D takes, opening for the rook. And queen comes here, a5. And c takes, knight takes. And this was a good move. The thing is, black would love for white to take on e6 because all the files it would be open. After this, the rook would come in, the bishop would hit c3, queen would hit c3, and white should be really, really careful. So he didn't take it, and this was, of course, never Karpov style. Here, he sort of took her in the break and played queen d2, said, okay, no more nonsense here. Let's have a normal position where you have a weakness, and I know what's going on. You might have the bishop pair, but I know what's going on, and this is important for me. Rook d8, okay, the roles has been reversed. To do it like that, sorry. Knight d4, okay, stopping all the dynamics, take bishop e2, queen b6, and here we can take stock. Black has an isolated pawn here, it's weak, but he has the bishop pair and active pieces, and I think the position is equal. Castle and knight e4, and I'm not sure it was necessary to exchange the knight, but it does make some sense. He could also try to develop, but he had some problems where to put his white squared bishop, so he decided to just get rid of the knight. And after queen c2, take, I think the best move here is bishop f5, because of course you cannot take it because of the pin here. And this is this would allow the bishop to sit on this square instead, where it was aiming at G2 and defending this pawn. Okay, I'll make that red. And at the same time, if white was to go f3, then e3 would be a weakness. And black is hoping for the bishop to get something going. So bishop e6 is probably a slight mistake. I think after this move, white is a little bit better. The bishop is passive here. It's, of course, sort of a bad bishop, but it is, all bad bishops are usually covering good pawns. So it's not completely useless. Queen c2, rook c8, and white is running away from the c-file because he knew something would come there. And rook c7, and what black is taking over the c-file, but and here is a important moment in the match. That Kasparov later won, but here Karpov makes a great move. We see that black has an isolated pawn, but he has compensation in the bishop pair and active pieces. And black, white decides to embark on the white symphony. From this move on until move, I don't know, I think it's move 39 or something, white only plays on the white squares. So here it comes, and are you ready? Yes. Take. Oh, there goes the isolated pawn. But let's see what happened. We have opposite colored bishops. And what is it with opposite colored bishops? Well, when you grow up, you hear that, oh, opposite colored bishops ensures it's a draw. But, and there's a big but here, that is, if there are other pieces on the board, it changes completely. It's only in opposite colored bishop endings. And the reason is clear. These two bishops, maybe the one red and the one yellow, lives in parallel universes. They can never meet. They can never exchange each other. They can never do anything to each other. One of them is totally on the white squares. The other is totally on the black squares. And that means on the white squares, white has one extra attacker. One extra attacker. And on the black squares, black has one extra attacker. But that's also mean that black has one less defender on the white squares, and black has one less defender on the black squares. So who gets to attack here? And we see instantly that due to this move here, and this pawn islands here, white squares are already weakened, while white structure is as healthy as they can come. So probably white is better here. And anyway, it's very unpleasant to play this kind of position against a player like Karpov. He just made one, here comes another. And we see that white's plan is clear. He will try to massage the position. At some point, he might go e4, changing it a little bit, opening for the rooks. But there's also another plan that we will see. He will try to arrange for a lot of move here, and that is to sit on this diagonal. And at the moment he's sitting there, but with the wrong piece on the wrong end. You want the queen to be first. If you could have a queen on d6 and a bishop on a b1, he could start attacking the black king. And notice that the black squared bishop will have a big problem just doing anything in this game. Why blacks, of course, try to be active, and this is probably the only thing he can do. He cannot really repair the white squares, so he will have to live with them. And white plays on another white square move, queen c6, queen d3, another white square move, putting it on king h8, so there's no check. Makes sense. Rook here. Just another white square move, a5, b3, making sure b2 is not a weakness anymore, and putting it on white, and another move. And he's white is very patient here. He's just waiting slowly to get this battery down to the queen, king going, or maybe playing e4 and attacking e6. Rook f8. And Black's is hoping one day to hit something here. This is where his counterplay could lie. It's a black squared pawn near the white king. Bishop h5. And we see again this idea with the diagonal b5, bishop d6, and now it is, and black couldn't prevent it anyway. So white is taking over the diagonal. At some point, he will get the queen into this battery, and this king will start to feel the heat. Bishop d3 hitting the pawn here. And Karpov always loved to win a pawn. So Karpov Kasparov have learned that learned during the way that you should not really allow him to do that, win a pawn. Queen d4, white squares are coming. Queen d6 is interesting, defends it, and Karpov thought it was time for e4 now. Just getting ready to get the rook into the e-file. And also at the moment, black looks kind of uncoordinated. Bishop d5. And let's exchange one rook. Just one rook, because that will... We know that white's attack is not going anywhere. But black will have less attack if there is only one rook. And Karpov had a very, very good sense for this. Queen c2, queen c6. And notice that Kasparov keep on trying to attack something, trying to do something, trying to annoy white, and queen c5. And here he's already really threatening to just take it, because there's a bishop e3 coming. So he should. So white has to play rook f1. But in normal games, you would say, okay, I'm pushing him back, I'm winning or something. But here, when you're playing against Karpov, it's clear that the white squares, they're not going anywhere. There, you have nothing to attack. He's sort of made a fortress everywhere. Queen c3, take. And notice, please notice that white is still only making moves on the white squares. Take. Bishop b1, still the white squares. And I'm sure Karpov really enjoyed that. It discovers the only pawn that was hanging, a2, queen d2. And unfortunately, here the white symphony ends, because white decides not to go to e6, but instead to go to e5. And of course, he's waiting for the queen to join the battery, starting the attack on the king. But he's also ready for this pawn to start rolling and pushing the bishop out and making not less active on the king side. Rook d8, queen f5, and that was nothing to do. So it's the first time white is actually threatening anything serious, and it's a mating threat, and you can't repair the king side, so the king will have to flee the scene. Check, and just to see, okay, I'm threatening mate again. Okay, we have to get the white the bishop in. So can black take the pawn? No, he can't take the pawn. Let's see the line. Rook e1, and I'm just gonna play rook e1, and this threat is devastating. So what to do about it? Basically, queen rook f8, queen e6, and you're flushed out. So queen c3. Queen d6, threatening it again. King g8, bishop e6. Okay, you might go to f8, just a little trap. Then the queen f7 is checkmate, so okay. And d3. Just bolstering the king side, getting ready to push the bishop back with h4. King f8. King d2. And this is something both Kasparov and Karpov keep doing. They keep on improving the position of the king whenever possible in these kind of position where it's clear that it will only be a mistake that will change the course of the game. So let's just decrease the likelihood of something stupid happening. And with the bishop, queen on the king on the white squares, there will be no bishop take something check. So That's just basically what's about. Queen h7, and of course white black couldn't force an exchange here with g6, the pawn sacrifice, but the ending is clearly losing. White's attack will keep on moving and he will get past rollers on the king side. So you get two passed pawns and the d pawn will be easy to control. So Kasparov is just hanging in there. By the way, he learned to avoid any kind of things that resembles this later on. And he never, I think at some point, he simply stopped accepting any kind of position that could lead to this kind of passive defense. And against Karpov, that's a very good idea because Karpov was extremely good at this. Okay, h4. So why are you pushing that back? Well, we will see. Bishop d2, because here comes the rook. The rook has been standing on f1, just guarding the pawn, but now it can come out. And when the tanks break free, bad things usually happen. It's attacking the bishop. And here comes the rook, and it's ready to rumble in the f-file. And of course, we also see that all white, the only sort of counterplay you could hope for was this. I'll not play that. Was this one running here? But all the pieces are controlling the d3 square, so the bishop, the pawn will not get anywhere. This is another thing of the opposite color bishop. By the way, strong players tend to be extremely good with opposite colored bishops, with pieces on like this. Karpov was excellent, but a lot of players, as Kasparov was also, of course, also great. And this is sort of the mark of a very strong player, is they can play these kind of positions very well. They're very good at assessing when is the opposite colored bishop a drawing force and when is it a big problem and giving me a great attack. And here, of course, is a problem. Bishop d6, rook f3, coming here. There will be some checks and something. And king is out. Queen is coming around the other way. d4, preventing the rook from going to e3, but queen c8, rook f6, queen c5. And we see that the king is not getting back to h8. It's kept out, and now the bishop is covered. The rook finds another way to join the game and join the attack. And we see that this bishop here is just a spectator. So white is a piece up in the attack, and this is of course winning. Queen b7 check, king, queen c4 check. King f8, and here comes a great move, use the whole board. We see that this bishop here is covering this rook, but it can also be used for aggressive things. So it comes here, and there's a nasty mating threat down here. So we'll say then. Rook f7, and this kind of defense is of course no defense at all. Queen e6. Threatening mate on e8, queen d7, still hoping to bail out into the ending, but of course white is not allowing that. And here, black resigned. The big threat right now is of course this move. It's just queen d8, and if black is to prevent it with something, then there will be a queen d6, or there will be a queen c5 or queen e8, and so the white queen is simply totally overwhelmed. So he resigned, and great game by Anatoly Karpov, one you should know. Thank you for watching GM Talks. This was the White Symphony, Murder on the White Squares in the World Championship match in 1985. Again, with the two great Ks.